What I personally feel towards Chögyam Trungpa Rinpoche is that immense connection, because of course because of previous Kente, I guess, but also what I feel very connected to Chögyam Trungpa Rinpoche is when I've heard stories from very close students as yourself, Mark Elliott, and Vivian Kurtz, and Jim Gimian, and Peter Walsh, and so on and so forth, all students of Chögyam Trungpa Rinpoche, I feel that Chögyam Trungpa Rinpoche is not somebody where what people describe him as, the crazy wisdom teacher, or the master of all illusion, or this Tibetan teacher who was brave and courageous and, you know, reenacted into the Western world of that era. And, you know, all of these people say, and then some people say, oh, Rinpoche was out of the control, and, you know, all of these things, how people see. But what I personally see him is a pioneer. And I see him as a truly spectacular gentleman in the world of the modern society and the society that Tibetans, we Tibetans live in, the old generation, the old-fashioned way, the older, hard-headed way. That Rinpoche was able to step both foot in different eras, in different circumstances, in different situations. And he was able to teach Dharma in such a way that people didn't just hear Dharma or listen to Dharma, but also understand the fundamental equanimity of Tibetan Vajrayana, Buddhism in general, and of course culture and customs, all in one sort of a circle, or all in one bowl. And also, you know, like I quite a lot like the fact that Rinpoche, Chögyam Trungpa Rinpoche, I can't describe much, but what I can describe a little bit was, in any attitude, in any actions, deeds, speech, what Rinpoche reenacted, or activities that he unfolded, had a piece of art in that sense itself. For example, I know many people will not agree with me. There will be a lot of disagreement to me, but he drank sake. That itself was an act of art. He smoked cigarette. That itself was an act of art. He used the Japanese emperor's fan, golden fan. That itself was an immense teaching of elegance, calmness, wisdom, awareness, mindfulness, and awareness, wisdom. And that itself is a piece of art. Everything is a piece of art. And especially, you know, this quote, victory over war. I think that itself sums everything up. People shall not remember Chögyam Trungpa Rinpoche as this master. People shall not remember Rinpoche as this crazy wisdom guy, or this crazy Tibetan man, or this man who tried to mingle with the Westerners. No. I purely feel nobody can opinionate. I'm sorry, maybe that is not a proper metaphor, but opinionate Chögyam Trungpa Rinpoche. We shall see him as who he was and what he approached to Buddha Dharma, to Vajrayana, to all of the students, to all of us in this world. I think people shall remember him as who he was. He was a pioneer and he was a hero. And that itself sums everything up. No more, no less, no more explanation is needed If people don't understand that factor, then I think it becomes the misconceptual perception of Chimukumbanichi. That's what I feel also. And also, I feel I have watched the document of Chimukumbanichi and the Crazy Wisdom, and sometimes I feel like it's not crazy wisdom, but it's more like when the wisdom is primordially pure, to the most purest state, it has no, you know, the substantial, you know, suited sort of base of yes, no, dirty and undirty, everything is pure. So once everything becomes pure, that luminous and luminosity becomes elaborate, and it becomes unconditional. So when it becomes unconditional, in some way you can explain it as wisdom becoming into the craziness. Or I would like to say wisdom at its purest peak. That's, I think, what people should understand. Not crazy wisdom. I think that is a big misconception. I'm sure some of you will be upset and maybe a little bit argument with me, but don't shoot the messenger. I feel, I tell what I feel. That is all what I want to say. Thank you.
One of the things we were talking about the other day is, of course, he was very shocking. He freaked us out in such a wonderful way. But what I really remember is his love, his unconditional love that he had for his students. And we were talking the other day, and you were talking about how he really sacrificed everything for us.
Yes, also, that's very true, because a Tibetan Lama like him could easily be like all of us, you know. We are so concerned about our looks, our position, our golden throne, our brocade, our golden jewelries, and all of this state and name. We are so attached to this, and we are so attached to nowadays reputations. But Chimukumbanichi, step by step by step, he did everything. He sacrificed his life, first of all, leaving his country. Of course, that was without choice, because Chinese was invading. And then coming to the West, especially in England, and studying in Oxford, you know, getting married to Diana. Is that correct?
Mm-hmm.
Diana Mumpo. That itself explains a lot of things. Why would any Tibetan Lama at that era would ever marry a Westerner, a local Westerner? There is no answer to that. That is only one answer that I feel is he gave up his monastic, this you know, life to preach Dharma into the world of the Western world. The only way to integrate with the Dharma into the Western world, only way to really, you know, inject with the Dharma into Western mind, Western society, Western life, is become one of them. You know, as we say, if you cannot debate, try to learn the other parts, qualities. So Rinpoche, just Chimukumbanichi Rinpoche, simply adopted the Western ideology, the Western society style, to teach and to change the Western world. Actually, all Chimukumbanichi senior students will agree with me that even though everything seems like Americanism and you know, Westernism, but actually everybody was, even though everybody thought they were Americans, but they were all turned out to become Tibetans. Rinpoche had that ability that nobody knew what he was doing, but at the end he made sure everybody became good Vajrayana students. In one part, he looked like he was just talking about normal Buddha Dharma, the conceptual thoughts about Buddha Dharma. But actually, he was trying to change everybody's life. He was trying to change the Western ideology. I think that is a very, very difficult thing to do, and you need all sacrifice to be done. He sacrificed everything. He sacrificed monastic life, his name, his fame, his reputation, everything, personal gain, whatever. Everything that to do with personal issues, he gave it up. Just for the sake of Buddha Dharma. To prevail Buddha Dharma, to prolong Buddha Dharma, and to change the Western society at that moment into Buddhist students. That's why we have all the senior students of Chibutum Paramji right now, all churned. You know, when you churn the milk, you get butter. You churn human beings' mind into Buddha Dharma, you get Buddhist Vajrayana students, Vajrayana patrons. That's what he did. And I think that is one of the most amazing things any teacher could have done.
Rinpoche, thank you very much. I think that puts it really, inexpressibly well.
And if I add a little bit that many, many teachers, you know, from their mouth, they sort of make fun of Chogyam Rinpoche, and they say, oh, this cannot work, this is an imbecile work, and this is stupid, this is not traditional, this is not existent work, this will never work. But the funny thing is that all the teachers who say bad things about Chogyam Rinpoche, who make comments on Chogyam Rinpoche's activity, all want to copy him. They all want to copy him in order to have proper Western students, in order to teach Westerners proper Buddha Dharma. There is no other method. The only teacher I think who was really fully able to get into a Westerner's mind is only Chogyam Rinpoche. There were so many great teachers, you know, starting from the Guchensa Rinpoche and the Dzogchen Rinpoche and Trujillo Rinpoche and His Holiness the 14th Dalai Lama, Dalai Lama, and then the 16th Karmapa. So great. But these teachers were different because they were so great and immensely amazing. Students were drawn to them. But a funny thing, do you notice that? Funny thing is that after all of these great teachers passed away, now nowadays, all the teachers are confused. They don't know how to handle Western students, so they try to copy everybody, and then they create a lot of mess. You know? I don't want to comment so much badly, but that becomes a huge mess. Huge mess, difficult to be solved. So I think nobody can copy Chogyam Rinpoche. He is one of a kind, and I don't think anyone should ever, you know, misjudge him. And have misunderstanding of his activities. Even though Rinpoche lived very shortly, I think that itself is a teaching. If Rinpoche would have lived right now, it would be great, but the weight of his activity won't be that much. Because Rinpoche lived so shortly, it was such a hit.
Yes.
All the students,
yes,
that it summed it up. Why he was there, what did he do, what was he for, and then end of the story. So I think that was the one of the most explicit teachings any teachers could have done. Thikku Chintu Rinpoche and Chogyam Rinpoche Rinpoche, so close, such so forth, maybe like brothers also. I can say there will never be a teacher like Chogyam Rinpoche. There never was like him. In such a way, I feel like Chogyam Rinpoche's activity is similar like Dzogchen Zishi Dorje, you know. Whatever he did for the Buddha Dharma, for the sake of sentient beings, but everything was against the human society, stupid human society, you know, what do you call that? Hard-headed, you know, mentality and system.
Yeah.
And I think that is one of the most greatest teachings and teachers ever lived. They will never be like him in the future. People can, you know, copy like him. But there is a saying, a cat can crawl like a tiger, but a cat cannot, you know, over sort of subdue or overcome the animal kingdom. Only a tiger or a lion can do that. The lion's roar can subdue all animals in the animal kingdom, and which his teachings will be, you know, shall always remain as a lion's roar throughout all centuries, throughout all decades. And that is what I make aspiration. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Rinpoche. I can't express how much that means to me. Beautifully, beautiful. Thank you again.